Back once again. Yeah, she's back. We want to thank, of course, Shirley Harrison for being in the spot that Vicki Belfiore normally occupies here on Preview, Sudbury's own arts and entertainment show.
To my right is Jack Richmond. Yeah.
Did you have a great 2 weeks? Did you miss us?
Oh, definitely,
well,
Jack.
I should
of course
hope
I did.
So. Wow. We have a terrific show lined up, and Vicki's going to tell you all about it as I get ready on set number one with some of the cast from one of the most fabulous shows that's ever gone on stage here in Sudbury. It's gone on stage in a new venue, Theatre Cambrian, not at Theatre Cambrian, but at the Mind Mill Hall. And we'll be talking about that with three of the Theatre Cambrian people, two who are on stage, as a matter of fact, later on tonight and through until the end of the month.
Great.
So I'm going over to that.
Goodbye, Jeff.
And you talk.
Yes,
yeah.
Wonderful. All kinds of things happening in the next half hour. Basically, I do want to mention that you can call in when we do our review of the movies a little later on in the half hour. Number is 560-1505 and 560-1506. Feel free to call in and let us know what you think about the movies that are playing in and around the city. As well, we have Iona Reed and Carl Prokera, the accordion duo. They'll be on the set today. And as well, Perry Lynn from the Sudbury Arts Council. Yvonne Morisseau will be showing some of her quill work. Fascinating stuff. And like Jack mentioned, Theatre Cambrian doing The Man Who Never Died. It's on now. It's at the Mind Mill Hall. I've heard tremendous things about it. And having actually worked with a couple of the people that are Jack is about to talk to, I know that the talents there are incredible. We've got Jamie Bourget, Marcia Ranger, and Dolores Thomas right now with Jack Richmond.
Well, Vicki just did the introduction to everybody. Dolores, Marcia, Jamie, glad to have you with us. We got a clip, by the way, showing Joe Hill and the whole gang, and The Man Who Never Died was actually produced, I understand, right here in Sudbury, had its premiere performance many, many years ago.
1955, world premiere. Mm-hmm. On the Mind Mill stage, the very venue where we're presenting ours at the moment.
So this is history revisited.
History revisited, yeah. Particularly with all of the revelations that have been in the paper in the last week.
This is incredibly timely.
Yeah, yeah. Right. It's amazing.
Yeah. And the story itself is, well, a timeless story, like Joe Hill himself. And I don't think you could have picked a better Joe Hill. Can you tell us something about your lead?
Well, Ray Morgan is our lead. He's from Onaping Falls. Mm-hmm. And Ray was in our production of Jesus Christ Superstar. Mm-hmm. As an apostle and also as a tormentor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but he's never had a lead role in a play before. When I approached him about it, he was very tentative. And I thought that he could do it. And he's turned out to be one of our best leading men at the company. I see great things for him if he decides to take theater on as a permanent career.
He's incredible.
Yeah.
He's incredible. You know, there's a bit coming up in our clip, and you look at him there, and it looks like something out of Les Mis.
Les Mis.
Yeah, and we'll see that in just a minute. Dolores Thomas, though.
Resident Jean Valjean.
Yeah, yeah, almost. Dolores, you're new on the stage at Theatre Cambrian.
Extremely new.
Yeah, but you really look like you're at home.
I feel at home in the show.
Yeah. Is it fun?
Oh, a lot of fun.
And you play a particular role. Can you tell us something about it?
Oh, you're speaking about Hilda Winton?
Yeah.
Oh, I find Hilda's character very fascinating. I enjoy playing Hilda, and I try to put myself in Hilda's place. So I'm really having a lot of fun with it.
Can you tell us something about Hilda, about the character?
Well, Hilda, she ran a boarding house. Mm-hmm. And when Joe came to America in that time, he was boarding with Hilda and Ben, which I don't have Ben on the show.
Ben is sort of off stage somewhere, right?
Yes, he did. But anyhow, Hilda take care of Joe when Joe got hurt. Mm-hmm. And she is very protective of Joe. So she do everything in her power to make sure no one hurts Joe.
Yeah, we're not going to tell folks what happened.
How
Joe got hurt.
We don't want to give away the clues. They have to come and see the show.
Well, Marcia, you're looking after a whole lot of stuff as well, too. Not on stage, but off stage. Tell us about what it's taken to get Joe Hill on stage.
Well, it's it's been very interesting. We had quite a time casting the show, including trying to find a black person to fill the Ben Winton role. We got an incredible amount of talent, considering that when I started out, we all agreed that we wanted people who were first-timers. Mm-hmm. And we have a good number of them in this cast. And with I've had a wonderful time liaising with the community, working with the Mine Mill people, and making this thing go. And I think it's great. It's wonderful.
I think it is, too. And we have teased people enough leading up to our clip. And we did this the other night, along with Wolf Hess from the CBC. Wolf was doing the audio, and I was there doing a bit of the video. So we're going to take just a bit now, and we can describe over the clip just what's happening.
Oh, yes. This is the Union scene, the International Wobblies of the World. That's Ree Morgan playing Joe Hill. A little bit of a disagreement amongst the rank and file there.
Yeah. Lois, there you are. And
that's Dave Tweedle playing Judge Mitchell. And Rudy Lindbergh playing the part of Moody, the copper baron. That's Ron Grigg playing the part of Ed Rowan. Francesco Martins.
Yeti Mascu.
There's an amazing number in the cast, too.
Yeah. We do have some people doubling up in roles, but 25 of us, 90% of the actors have never been on stage before. It's Kevin Kloss on banjo in the background. He wrote a lot of original music for the show.
And these are all Joe Hill's songs here that we just brought out all over again.
Mm-hmm. You see a closer shot of Kevin coming up here in just a few moments from an exit stage here.
Mm-hmm. Gee, it looks great on video.
Yeah.
Well, it looks great when you're there.
Yeah, it's live too.
And you see Kevin there with the guitar.
You're right. It does look like shots out of Les Mis. It's wonderful.
So that's just a sample. Now people have to go and see for themselves, and they are not very far away from the stage because of the unique setting that you have designed at the Mine Mill Hall. Can you tell us something about that?
Yeah, when Mine Mill first approached us, we read the script and we said, well, it's not our kind of show. Our audiences expect a certain kind of show from us. And we've certainly never done a heavily pro-union show before. So Bob Ivey, who is our production coordinator and one of his functions is set designer, and Bob Ivey and I and Marcia sat down and in a restaurant, and this is how we always come up with our set concepts. You know, we are over on a serviette,
right,
next serviette. And we said, well, let's do something different, something that's a challenge for Theatre Cambria. And it's already been done on the regular stage at the Mine Mill Hall, which is a proscenium arch stage, mm-hmm. your usual gym of stage. Let's do something different, theatre in the round. So we've actually located our stage, which is a square with a diamond on top and a ramp coming out. Right in the middle of the hall, and we have a four-sided audience. So the audience surrounds us. So, and that is called Theater in the Round.
Marcia, we only have a few seconds left, really. Why should people go out and see this play?
It's Theater Cambrian signature. It's community, which is wonderful. You have people you know right there on stage. They're just the people you work with. And we're running until the 27th, except for Sunday the 21st. And we'd like to see everybody on all four sides of that stage.
Yeah. And of course, Dolores, this is really a labor story. It's a Sudbury story.
Yes, it is.
And of course, it is great theater. too.
A great theater and a great show, and I urge each and every one to come out and see it.
Well, I went. I certainly enjoyed it, and I'd recommend it to everyone as well, too. Thanks very much for coming out.
You're quite welcome.
And get back there, break some more legs.
We certainly will.
Thank you.
And now, with what else is on, here, once again, is Vicki.
So what to do and where to go this weekend? Well, after you catch the Mine Mill Hall's Theater Cambrian's performance of The Man Who Never Died, then you can go to City Lights, for instance. This Saturday, they feature Road Apples, the tribute to the tragically hip. Mine Mill Hall downstairs on Saturday, the Sudbury Blues Society is holding a fundraiser. Blues DeVille is playing. Doors open at 8:30, and they encourage you to bring non-perishable food items. The Grand Theater, Tuesday night, the 23rd of November, it's Nana Muscuri. There are still some tickets left. Call 67GRAND to reserve yours. The International features Wexler's Curtain. The Rodeo Bar at the Sorrento from Thursday to Saturday night features Alligator Cowboy. They are straight from Florida, as a matter of fact. The following Saturday at the Rodeo Bar, it's Sudbury's own Loma Linz and the 13th Floor. As well, the Valley Inn and Azilda features Silver Eagle, a country rock band. And Buddies in the Hanmer Valley Shopping Plaza features the Buckeye Boys. Finally, at the Northland, Friday and Saturday, it's Tara Kane, and she's promoting her first CD. It's called Religious Promiscuity. Check that out. Okay, next we've got the performance, an accordion performance from Carl Pucara and Iona Reed. And Carl Pucara, and that was a performance piece, I understand. Jack?
Yeah, we should mention that Iona and Carl also do dinner engagements. They do dances. Those are their more classical performance pieces. They're award-winning, world-renowned accordionists. It's great to have them here on the show with us.
It shows. And okay, now I've been gone for a couple of weeks, so I don't know what movies you've seen.
Well, we've talked, Shirley and I've been here. We've talked about you know, the Beverly Hillbillies, about the Halloween Before Christmas show, and you know, we're looking forward to a movie that's coming up very, very shortly. As a matter of fact, I think it opens Friday at the Super Mall. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about it?
Yes, let me guess. It's My Life you're
my
talking
life.
About.
Yes,
oh, okay,
right,
My Life. Yeah, My Life does open Friday. And it features Michael Keaton mm-hmm. and Nicole Kidman, mm-hmm. as a matter of fact. And basically, it's, I guess, a love story. Mm-hmm. And it shows the love between a husband and wife, a husband and an unborn child, as well as the man in his own identity. Basically, he's got cancer, and his wife is pregnant, and he wants to be sort of, I mean, he doesn't know if he's going to be around, so he basically teaches everything to his child on videotape.
Apparently, at least that's what this clip sets it up. Maybe we should take a look at it, and then we'll go to the movies.
Let's do that.
Okay, look, I'm just gonna do this, okay? I'm sorry if it doesn't all make sense, but I may not have a lot of time here. So, the fact is, I'm supposed to be dying. I've got a disease called cancer. There are a lot of different kinds of cancer. Mine started in my kidneys, spread to my lungs. Now I have a doctor, nice enough guy, says we're gonna try all kinds of experimental therapies. But the truth is, he doesn't really think I'm gonna make it. I plan to prove him wrong. Now the tricky part here is not that I'm supposed to be dying, but that you're about to be born. Okay, here are some facts. We all die. Not pleasant, but we do. It happens. I could get hit by a truck tomorrow, hopefully not a large truck. I could be sleeping, palm tree crashes through the bedroom ceiling, kills me, it's over. Could happen. If something like that did happen, it'd really be a drag, because there are a lot of things I want to tell you and say to you. There's not a lot you can trust in this world. There just isn't. So, I wanted to leave you this videotape, for better or for worse, so that you know something about me, who I am. Well, this is me.
That's a good idea, don't you think? I mean, but we don't know what happens at the end of that movie, so we'll go to the movies and maybe to talk a little bit more about it next week.
And you can go too, and if you have any comments, you can always give us a call. We're live on Thursday nights at 6:30 here on Cable 7, and you can see us again on Fridays at 5, Saturdays at 4:30, or early on Sunday mornings at 8 o'clock.
Yeah, but since we're live right now, you can call us. It's 560-1505 or 560-1506. Let us know about any movie you've watched. Actually, I've gone to watch a movie recently. It's still playing.
Yes.
It's Flesh and Blood. It stars Meg Ryan and her husband, Dennis.
Okay, tell the truth. Wait. What happened now when you went to this movie?
Yeah. I was going to just, basically what happened is I missed the first few minutes and sort of was lost throughout the, do not miss the first few minutes of this movie, because it basically tells you what's going on. And if you miss it, you kind of interpret your own storyline and...
So you're either going to have to go again, or you're going to have to rent it in video to see what happens.
Well, no, I asked around.
Oh, yes.
And I said, what's going on? So anyway, don't be late for it. It is actually very good. And, yeah,
okay.
It shows that evil doesn't have to run in the family.
Well, that's,
so there's a bit of...
That is very reassuring.
Yeah. I would have given it, I know you object and see it, but I would have given it about a 6.5 to 7 out of 10. It's pretty good. Mm-hmm. And Dennis and his wife Meg seem to work well together, so I enjoyed it. Now, since... You haven't seen any recently? Talk about any movie you want, Jack.
Well, I want to talk about one of my favorites.
Or we can answer the phone and not talk to you at all.
Somebody called. Somebody called. Is there somebody on the phone? Yes? No?
Well,
apparently they're not. It's a false alarm. So I'll talk about Sleepless in Seattle, my all-time favorite summer movie.
Yeah, you mentioned that.
You know, and it's interesting. There's so many great songs in that. But just to show you how they sometimes milk a good idea, they've come up with a new CD that features more songs for sleepless nights. Now, these are not songs that are in the movie.
No.
But they're songs that they put together, you know, sort of those romantic type songs, like I'll See You in My Dreams, My Funny Valentine, all that sort of stuff. Are we going to see that clip this week or not? No, we're not.
When I fall
And that song is on the CD.
No, that song is in the movie.
But it's also on the CD,
When I Fall in Love. Oh, yeah, yes. By Nat King Cole. It's done by Celine Dion.
Oh, and Clive Griffith, I believe is his name. Did you want to take the call? We have a call.
Okay, I'll push the button. You say hello.
Hello, preview.
Hello, how's it going?
Not bad. How's it going with you?
Oh, not too bad, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
I was just wondering as to your opinion on B-movies and how you think a B-movie festival would go over in the Sudbury region.
I love B-movies. I don't know why, but they seem to have a little more heart to them for some reason.
I've heard a few comments on things like that. I think it has its following. I think it would probably do well in the city if somebody tried to, you know, arrange something.
There's some talk, I don't know if the caller realizes this, but in certain other cities about our size, like Thunder Bay, they have many, 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 many more screens and the opportunity to show a lot more of those type of films.
Yeah.
Would you go to see B-movies if they were shown?
For sure. I'm an avid renter.
Well, then you should organize it. Get something together, do kind of a weekend thing. Okay?
Well, okay, thank you.
No
and then
problem.
We'll have a B-movie review right here on Preview.
Exactly.
Right.
Bye-bye. Thanks for calling.
Thank you.
Hey, wait. Review Jason Goes to Hell, too.
Okay. I'll let Jack watch
time.
That one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hey, thanks.
Scary.
Thank you. And just to kind of wrap up, I'd just like to go over the movies rather quickly. City Center is featuring Three Musketeers, Flesh and Bone, Beverly Hillbillies, and Fatal Instinct. Also on Friday, Adam's Family Values will begin. Supermallet's Nightmare Before Christmas, you saw that one. And RoboCop 3, Cool Runnings as well. And My Life starts on Friday. And finally at the Odeon, Carlito's Way, Look Who's Talking Now, and Malice. And right now, here's Perry Lynn with the Sudbury Arts Council events.
Thanks, Vicki. Okay, this week we have lots of activities going on. For starters, tonight, Secondary School is presenting No Frills Review, and that's on until the 20th, so the end of the weekend, at the Sudbury Secondary Auditorium. Tomorrow night, Lauren Elliott, in conjunction with United Way, will be performing at the Grand Theater. He's a comedian, and he's very popular and very funny. On Sunday, November 21st, we have the Sudbury Art Club doing the Christmas exhibition. They'll be showing lots of paintings from 11 to 5 at the Grand Theater, room 223. On Monday, November 22nd, Famous People Players Magic Show will be performing at the Grand Theater. And on Tuesday, November 23rd at the Grand will be Nana Mouskouri. Okay, on Thursday, November 25th, the Sudbury Arts Council presents Christmas Fantasy. This is an arts and craft fair at the City Center of 50 local talented artists. And that evening, the Sudbury Writers Guild will be having their regular meeting at the Church of Epiphany. On Saturday, November 27th, the Sudbury Opera Guild will be presenting an Opera Weekend Getaway. And the Sudbury Arts Council will also present Celebrity Art Class. Come out and watch 10 local dignitaries try painting for the very first time. Finally, in that morning, actually prior to coming out to that event, the Sudbury Art Club will be having an art morning at 9:30 a.m. in the Grand Theater, room 223. That's it for this week. Now over to Jack Richmond and Yvonne Morisseau.
Yvonne is a fantastic person. We keep running into you. We did a bit during the Studio Arts Tour a couple years ago. We had hides out. We were working with them. We had you with the quill work, and since that time, run into you several times. And you just never seem to stop. You're everywhere. You're even on tour. How do you do it?
Well, the thing is, it's a driving force to revive the art of quilling. And as I'm traveling, I'm always learning something new and different. It's so interesting.
Where have you been lately?
I just came back from Port Huron. Mm. I did a workshop for them for Willow Winds. I was at Muncie, Indiana. I've got a call for art for Indianapolis, Milwaukee. I'm going to be doing a few artists in the school programs.
We got some of your stuff here now. A lot of it is on display right now here in Sudbury.
Oh, it's at the Cancer Center.
Mm-hmm. So if you take a look at some of the stuff we got here and then take a look at what you got at the Cancer Center, this is just part of it. You have so much.
Well, the thing with the quilling, it was almost a dying art.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's in my mind, it wasn't realistic to keep making mucklucks, moccasins, knife sheets, powwow cuffs. In my mind, if it was going to survive or be revived, it had to take on a different form. So this is, I started off trying to accomplish what an artist did with paint, and then I kept dwelling into more detail, and trying to inaugurate a lot of the different stitches and the raw materials in all my work.
And you've done it, because if the average individual looks at what you've done from a slight distance back, They'd swear it was painting. But then you get close and you can see the quills themselves. And of course, these are quills that are into actual hides.
Right. And I try to keep it all on home tan hide. Now, on that pipe bag, there is two different kinds of stitches. Mm-hmm. Down the bottom to create the lacing, that's one of the wrappings. The blue tassels are actually horsehair. The cones are my sardine cans. On the butterfly, it's the rawhide hoops. I'm making the hoops out of the rawhide rather than have the steel hoops that you see
in the
dream catchers. Then again, there's another stitch that's actually quills that the piece is tied onto the rawhide with.
This is amazing.
So that's a
Vicki
different
and
stitch.
Perry Lynn, come on over here and take a look at some of the stuff as we get set to say goodbye, because we don't nearly have enough time because Vicki talked too long tonight.
Thanks.
And you got to tell me what this is.
That's spruce bark.
This is spruce bark. Spruce bark, you know, this is really amazing. You have to see this.
Okay, and now this is another thing. Utilizing everything from nature.
Yeah. I mean, we don't have time to talk about it. No, our time is up again. So once again, you can see what you have on display over at the Cancer Center.
Yeah, and I'll be doing some more workshops if anybody wants to contact me.
And we'll be letting folks know right here on Preview. Thank you very much for coming out.
Great.
Bye for now. See you next week.
Bye.